Harmvekin from Fier Automotive. He has over 30 years of experience in the automotive industry, and his field of interest includes incentives for electric driving in Europe and support policy framework at various levels of governance in Europe and the US.
Good morning, everybody, or the good afternoon, depending on which region you are. I'm a managing partner of Fier Automotive, a Dutch business development consulting company on electric mobility. What I'm going to do is to give you some snapshots, some quick, some slides as an appetizer into the topic of charging infrastructure and the relation, of course, with the uptake of e-mobility. Just some highlights. I would like to invite you also to discuss more in detail the approaches on charging. We work with quite a lot of cities and national governments, but also with European Commission on charging infrastructure, also involved in discussions around the current regulation of the European Commission. So quite into the topic. Happy to go with the cities. I saw there are some local authorities in the room. With national authorities, but also with the institutes, the academia, will often work with the local authorities to go further in detail about this. Now, quickly, the overview, quick, some slides about the importance, open doors, then something about typologies, then standards, interoperabilities, and something about the planning process. And there are many other topics where we can dive into, but not today. Well, yes, it's a little bit open door. Of course, you need the electricity to get the vehicle moving. So it has to be, the chargers have to be available throughout the country, throughout the city. It has to be the right charging speed. And so that's the one side. And of course, the user interaction and satisfaction is extremely important. So it has to be reliable, it has to be user-friendly. This might seem like buzzwords, open doors, but it's really extremely important. And we see that in the first steps of electric mobility, here often mistakes are made, very, very many. Of course, obvious, the charging speed, if you are standing somewhere for 10 hours where you only have 1 hour, it's no use. Also, you need to reach it. So, and it's not theoretical calculations about how many, it's also about that there should be certainty for the user to be able to charge. By the way, this counts for both fleets, commercial fleets, heavy duty fleets, as well as for passenger cars. But reliability, so it has always needs to work. So not it's a uptime of 90% or 95%. It has to always work. It has to always interact with your vehicle, with your charging car, and it has to be very user friendly. So without hassle. From those who are already experienced electric mobility, they know that user friendliness is a real hurdle often. I will show some examples later on. But also the business case, because we saw too many times that the calculation of the charges is done bottom-up from the infrastructure investments. But in the end, it has to be supportive for the business case for e-mobility. So this is a very important element. So the electricity has to be cheaper than driving the petrol or diesel. If we look at the major concerns, and I can only see part of the slide because the participants list is over it, but what we see that the concerns of the EV drivers in studies that have been done with McKinsey, but also our own studies and show this, is that the driver is moving, the concerns are moving away from, is the vehicle available? What is the cost of the vehicle? All those things get less important because they know now that it's cheaper to drive, that vehicle of their choice is there, but they see that the battery driving range, certainty of charging, battery degradation, so everything around the charging and the battery is getting more important over the years. This is a substantial concern of the user. So if we look at the KPIs, the critical performance indicators, and then we see that, in, that one of the main elements are to ensure sufficient coverage, that there are enough charges, but also that there are, of course, can be found and that they are registered, the very important ones. That it's very important that it happens. And there are in Europe all kinds of ways to enforce, by the European Commission, the countries who have enough spread of charges. Can be done per capita, per kilometer, can be done by density of population. It can be done by electric vehicles registered in the country. So, and of course, with fast charging on highways, it can be done in a way that you can charge every, let's say 50, 60 kilometers, discussion now at the European Commission. But of course, at that location have to be enough charges so that you're not queuing, because you already have to wait a little bit for the car is full, so you don't want to queue. But also seamless charges, so cross-border, being able to pay with one app, one card, with one payment instrument, whatever, has to be seamless, straightforward, without difficult registration processes. No anti-competition, no customer lock-in, not competition lock-out elements that we see a lot in Europe currently. So it's important that not to make the same mistake. Now, payment has to be easy, and facilities, when we speak about fast charging along the highways where you have to wait maybe 20 minutes, it's nice that you can also eat, drink and go to the toilet. Looking into the different charging typologies, and this is something where we could speak an hour about, so we're not going to do that all more than an hour, but just some highlights. Of course, you can all you know all the situations, like when we speak about passenger cars, we see home charging. Are you living in a high-rise building? It's different. If you have your own driveway, it's much more easy to realize. As a city, it's also a nice challenge. If you have a lot of people with the cars on the street being parked or in the park houses, then there's different challenges than when everybody has a nice home with a drive lane. If we look at recharging at the highway, it has to be fast, it has to be convenient. Recharging at work, other demands can be slower, it can be, when often the smart charging is extremely important. So different versions for charging when you are using for private vehicles. And this is also where normally the discussion focuses at. And then we come to the next one. So we look at the commercial fleets recharging. We see the taxi fleets, fast throughput, not have to wait, be able to maybe have an advantage when you charge. Like if you go to Amsterdam, you will see that taxis can go in front of the queue as soon as they have charged their system. The charges that is at the waiting location. High-speed truck charging, so really high powers, working towards 3 megawatts in Europe, for example, at the moment. Opportunity charging for logistics, for example. So if you have long haulage, but also you want to have it if you have logistics, regional transport integrated in logistics systems. When you are in the city distribution center, so charging when you load and unload the vehicle, for example, waste collection, completely other ballgame, completely other demand. Buses, combination of opportunities, depot charging. So lots of different systems, and that's we looked at very carefully. We made an overview, but I will not go into detail for the charging profiles, typologies for the private vehicle charging. So like charging in the parking garages, for example, at daytime, but you can also, if you look at nighttime, parking garages, different demands, but also there are different demands from the technology. How are you going to get the power into an existing building without too much cost, and how do you charge in a way that's smart? Maybe you can use the batteries of the different vehicles when the vehicle to get, or opportunities to charge from one vehicle into the other. Even maybe you can make all kinds of arrangements, but charging, for example, in parking garages is when it's not prepared for it, it's not easy to arrange. So you have to think ahead. So it's a charging pattern, different at daytime, different when you are somewhere eating, at a restaurant or something, you have different different demands. The speed is different, the business model is different. So lots of things to look into. In line with this, I would like to step towards the standards and interoperability. And let's say this is one of the biggest pitfalls. And I come from Europe, so I've seen all the learning effects here. And it's really important not to make the same mistakes, but to look at what can we learn from the situation that's now existing in Europe, or even with improvements. It's always improvements. And we have to, for technical standards and interoperability, it's one side is technical, but it's also a commercial game between the sector and the users, the cities. Where do the bucks, where do the dollars, where do the euros land? Because at the moment, especially the first start, it's difficult to get the charging systems profitable. So it's always looking at where do I earn money, but it's not always in the interest of society. So as a public authority, you really have to be very careful about how you plan your charging infrastructure, how you do your concessions. So, I understood from the former presentation that this was in some cases already a eye-opener. There are, of course, different standards for slow charging, so the AC side here. In North America, in Japan, that are the same types. And then the European standard, the Mannekes plug, type 2 plug. The Chinese plug is different. For DC, it's the same, more or less the same situation. So the Japanese standard being CEDEMO for fast charging. This is important because we have learned in some of the projects in Solution Plus that it's perceived that the standards are defined by the manufacturer, but it's not the case. You as a country, you define, or as a continent, or as the combination of countries, which standards you approve in your country. This is very important. And it's not only for passenger cars, but it's also for buses and trucks. We know the examples where, for example, also for the Chinese buses often, they come with their own standard. And then you are locked in. You are always, even at the manufacturer side, you have to buy the same bus because you only have your charging infrastructure, and you don't want that. You want to enforce on the suppliers of the vehicle suppliers, charging suppliers, your standards as a country, so that you are free and that your customers, most passenger cars, can roam through the country easily. But this is only about roaming them for the technical side. There's much more behind it. Of course, same discussions about pantograph, not pantograph. Important, I'll show in, I think, the next slide. Yes, so how to charge buses, how to charge trucks. And this is also something to look into, because the easiest way is I have here a bus. It's a diesel bus. I'm going to replace that by an electric bus, because it can, and I do want to do the same kilometers mileage per day. So I take a bus with a big battery. That might be the cheapest solution for the short run. So I'd only do that, I buy it now, 10 buses and I charge you overnight. But if you look at the whole city, it might be much cheaper to have lots of opportunity chargings underway, to have some buses with smaller batteries, where the infrastructure investments are very much higher, but the vehicle investments might be lower. And if you take into account logistics planning, so the number of kilometers being able to be done and the data in the per day, you might be much better off. This is exactly when you speak to VDL, when you speak to Volvo, when you speak to ABB, where the European industry differentiates, where they can really help you also with maybe not always the cheapest solution in the beginning, but all in all, in the whole system planning, the best and ultimately also the cheapest solution all in all. So this is important. And this you can put on every case. You can put it on taxis. You can put it on buses, on trucks situations. So look at what is the optimum, what's the sweet spot. You can also, of course, start to lengthen the trips. EV charging market. many stakeholders involved. Again, we're going back now to the passenger car market, I would say, because it's the most developed in this slide. Passenger car market, energy suppliers, infrastructure, charging point, the infrastructure producer that manufactures the charge poles, heavy duty, small ones, slow, and for heavy duty, fast charging, slow charging, so multiple ones. Charge point operator, the one who owns the network. There can be also be a site host. For example, you can have a CPO, a charge point operator, can have the charges at a gasoline station of another brand being located. What's not on the slide is the back office systems to manage all the charge network. The e-roaming, so how do you go from one to the other network so that you can use all of those charges in different locations, different cities, different highway locations. So many different roles. And they need to work together. And for this, standardization is needed. Interoperability, technical interoperability, communication systems, communication standards, so that you can, with one charge badge or app or whatever, is also accepted at other locations. This is, I believe, the left one was an example for Germany of charge cards, different cards, different logos, different providers. You can see what happens on the right side. This is one of my colleagues with different cards being used in different locations driving around. And this is not a joke. It's just really the case that if every charge point operator has his own system, and if they don't cooperate, and if they block their system for others, that is getting difficult. In the Netherlands, you can go around with one charge card. It doesn't have to be a card. It can be all kind of ways. Roaming is very cheap. So you all remember the telecom cost being skyrocketing in the past when you wanted to roam to another country. Within a country, you also have to roam with charge from one network to another network. And then you go abroad, you use other networks, and you really want to avoid that this roaming is difficult and expensive. This is what we have done in the Netherlands. Do this from the first day on when you start with electric mobility in your city and in your country, and demand this from the sector. So otherwise you have to dive, like the European Commission now, in all kinds of regulations to repair that later on, to take care that roaming is easy and cheap. And of course, it's also not easy for the sector, because they just want to provide service quickly to new drivers, and having to make all those agreements and contracts. Also, this has to be easy. Standardization, interoperability. It starts with the technical standards between, for example, the vehicle and the charger need to be able to communicate. It's getting less and less, but the number of times that it doesn't work, it was quite high. So that the, for example, Renault Zoe in the big early days not communicating correctly with the charger, charging going down, where there's not power, the Zoe stopped charging, not starting up. All those things are important. And then you're standing there, on the, you doesn't charge, so you cannot continue. So you want to have this working properly. The ISO standards, integration testing, how does it work? Very important. But also then communication between the charger and the charge point operator. So OSPP is the standard. I would say it's also standard worldwide, getting standard worldwide. Very happy with that. Developed in the Netherlands and then adopted by other countries who are together are improving it all the time. Also for example, for charging back from the vehicle into the grid, same the standards are being improved. But then also the communication between the charge point operator and the one where you as a user buy your charge card or your whatever system from, and you have want to roam with this over all the different charge point networks. The communication of the data done by, for example, OSPI, but also others are around there. There is a little bit of a jungle with multiple standards, which also makes it sometimes expensive, because then you get roaming platform that can charge fees. What is interoperability in the electric mobility ecosystem? It is the ability of vehicles, chargers, networks, and management systems to interact and manage data to ensure that you can charge safe. Let's open the door so that you don't you're not electrocuted, electrified yourself. The compatibility of equipment and protocols, it has to be functional, it has to work easy, it has to be reliable, always work, system has to be available. And you can see here all the actors again, so from the vehicle power supply, apply energy management, you can see it on the slide. Then something where we don't have much time for now, but this is something that we can, we're happy to speak with the local authorities, like I said, national authorities, but also with the academia, the institutes about, is the city planning of the charging network. So we worked with a number of cities on how to plan the charging infrastructure. Where you look at the different levels of what you can include in the mapping to define the charges. For example, looking at the grid, where's the power supply, looking at the flows, the patterns, where do people move, where do they drive to, is it from home to work outside the city? Is it from outside the city to certain shopping malls areas or entertainment areas? So the different locations, and you want to know that. You also want to know where the big flows go through the city, so maybe you can connect some things. You want to know where the charges are currently, how are they used, is it heavy used, is it, do you need new ones, how far do people have to walk when they are living in a certain area, so that they can charge easily, are there parking spaces that are not utilized at night, so all those things you want to have, and you want to start for proper planning. It's not all deep technologies, analyzes, it's also common sense. So looking at how Oslo did that in the early days, it was really very common sense. Looking at where are the locations, there and there's so much power issues in other cities there are, so that makes it sometimes easier. But it's also very much common sense. So looking into where would I like to have it located. I use the stakeholders, so hotels, shopping malls. For them, it's attractive to offer additional services. Look at where the big employers, where are they located that have are going to deploy large fleets for their company cars of their employees. So involve them in your planning. It's going to be expensive. This city planning, realizing of the charging infrastructure. So involve the stakeholders so that you can make it cheaper. And of course, you can. There's always the possibility to have the private sector investing, but even then, that costs money. So the lower it can be, those costs, the better for the business case of electric mobility. But also, where do the affluent people with higher income levels live? Where you think also the ones that are the innovators, what the earliest one adopting and buying electric vehicle, where do you expect the hotspots for electric vehicles in your city in the next years? So you can plan ahead on this. You can make charging charging locations with multiple charges around a local church or a local or a supermarket or whatever in a neighborhood where you can say there's then I don't have to, to then I can read the occupation of the charges is good, not for every house. Look at the grid. Where is the grid availability in the city? Make your smart combinations, like if there's already big power supply at the metro station or whatever. Look if you can connect to this. It's making things cheaper. And the power is often not used during the whole day on those locations, so it's also easier for the capacity that you have to install at those locations, because you can have the charging also being smart. Moving with the availability. evaluate with utility company, electricity, the grid company in your region. And also next slide about this, but also look, it's important to start looking ahead into smart charging and vehicle to grid, both for your renewables in the city that will flood the city at certain points with renewables. And believe me, it's happening in some cities in the Netherlands. So especially in other countries, but more sunshine, it will also happen, depending on the quality of your grid. And on the other hand, the car is starting to charge locations where you don't have the power. But you can balance that. You can use let me see, that's the next slide, I think. All right, that's the one after. I'll come back to that in a second. But also making smart combinations in city hubs. So look at where you can co-locate charging locations. Public transport with passenger cars, urban trucks. So look at where is the most logical location to combine. And also look at horses for courses. So very dedicated solutions. If you look at what many of the cities were working in a solution plus, it seems that for swapping systems for scooters, for e-tuk-tuks, it's much more an open door than, for example, installing the charging locations. But you can use the storage centers where you can do the swapping. Also, you can integrate that in those hubs, for example, and you can use them again also for smart charging if you have enough batteries for e-scooters. It's just a numbers game. How many are there? How much is available? Smart charging, charging back into the grid, just loading back electricity into the grid. Let me see. Oh, that's the, yeah. So this is then so multiple layered map where different all the systems come together and where you can start to do the planning for your charging fallout. As a city, think ahead. Think ahead about what you want as data. This is just an example of a monitoring system. I don't think the private sector will solve this. As a city, you want to be in control about what, where the charges are, or how are they used, where do you need to expand. It is also connected to your mobility planning, where you want to have the cars, where you don't want to have them. So it's really, it's your city, it's the city of the inhabitants, so it's your data. Do this from the start, because otherwise you get the situation like in the US in the beginning, where you have four charges next to each other with four batches, four different providers. And depending on which subscription you have, you can use one of the cards. Who's going to pay? Society, because you need the grid installed at the moment when there is peak demand. You can make arrangement with those charge point operators about being able to do smart charging over the system. They will ask money for that. So you're in control. You're the one who makes the rules. It's your society. It's society that pays in the end. So having a good data, being in control, demanding that data already in the contract is very important. Come back to that in my next slide. Going back to the grid cost, avoid really high investments. It's not at the moment, and we start with 10 charges in the city, it's not an issue. But if it's thousands, then that's an issue. But you can use the vehicle, you can use the charger to even make the uptake of renewables better. So you can store at the moment when there's a peak load of electricity, you can store them in the vehicles. When there is not enough, and this is not far future thinking, because the vehicles are coming out that are able to charge back into the grid, both AC, so slow charging, as DC, is being prepared by all manufacturers, meaning that you can start to also load back into the grid when all the microwaves and all the cooking and all the heating, the heat pumps or the echoes go in parallel are starting. So there is the option to avoid high grid costs. Very important, because the highest investment in electric mobility, far higher than the infrastructure itself. Lowering the energy costs, we make use of the low rates during the day, when there's a flooding of renewables on your grid. Less CO2 emissions, because you can store it. You don't have to stop windmills from working, because that's too much. You can store it in the vehicles. And less dependence on fossil fuels in this case. So very important. public procurement is a very powerful tool. I already explained the importance of setting the right demands when you roll out your charging system in your city, together with Polis, also Solution Plus partners, with TNO, also Solution Plus. We have done in our project in the work that we do for the European Commission on the EA for portals, European Alternative Fuels Observatory. Please take a look, you'll find lots of interesting data. We have done a handbook on how cities can go, how they can do the public procurement, how they can charge. And how they can attract the companies to install chargers in the cities. Public procurement is one of the most powerful tools. More powerful even than regulation and legislation. But in the public procurement, you define as a city who's going to install chargers, operate chargers, and under what conditions. So the interoperability, very important. Seamless charging. In city level, of course, also on national level, but also the positive business case for electric mobility users, for CPOs and society. So you define there, for example, what kind of access you have to the chargers, both on data, but also on smart charging. You define what kind of maximum pricing can be into it. You can ask for the lowest price. You can do all kinds of things. But think ahead. And this is something we really, from the Solution Plus project, we have time available. Happy to work with you and set out these demands. The handbook is there. Happy to go through with it in detail. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much, Harm.